Funding for this firing line debate was made possible by a grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, the Annenberg Foundation, and the Laurel Foundation.
Good evening. From Bard College in Annandale, New York, welcome to a special all-star firing line debate. Our topic tonight is resolved. All immigration should be drastically reduced. Note that word all. This debate is not just about securing America's borders against illegal aliens. It is about cutting the total number of immigrants, both illegal and legal. So it's really a debate about the nature of American society. Are we a nation of immigrants, tied together by America's values, but by no particular ethnic background? Or is that just a lot of sentimental claptrap? Does immigration at current levels threaten not just our economic prosperity, but American culture as well? Including illegals, more than 2 million foreigners are moving to the United States every year. In absolute terms, that's an all-time high, although as a fraction of the population, it's nothing particularly unusual. But today's immigrants are different. Most of them come from Asia and Latin America, not from Europe. Does that matter? Well, that's just one of the questions you'll hear debated tonight. Immigration is sure to be an issue in next year's election campaign. Last year, the voters of California approved Proposition 187, which denies public education and other social services to illegal aliens. The welfare bill now being debated in Congress would deny welfare benefits even to legal immigrants. And a government commission on immigration is expected to recommend this month that the total number of legal immigrants be reduced by one-third. So before it gets totally enmeshed in politics, here is your chance to think and hear about the immigration debate in its pure, high-minded form. Let's welcome tonight's pure, high-minded debaters, all eight of them. One interesting thing about tonight's debate is how many of the debaters are themselves immigrants. That does not, of course, include the captain of the affirmative team, William F. Buckley, Jr. Mr. Buckley is the founder and star of Firing Line, the founder of National Review, syndicated columnist, author of books too numerous to mention, all-around great American. Mr. Buckley actually traces his ancestors in this country back to the early Bronze Age. Traces his politics back to the same period, and they haven't evolved one little bit since then. Peter Brimelow is a double immigrant from Great Britain by way of Canada. Indeed, he was once considered America's best leading expert on Canada, not that there was a lot of competition for that title. Mr. Brimelow is presumably not referring to himself in the title of his controversial new book, Alien Nation, Common Sense About America's Immigration Disaster. Mr. Brimelow is a senior editor of both Forbes magazine and the National Review. Arianna Stassinopoulos Huffington is also a double immigrant from Greece by way of Great Britain. She's a former president of the Cambridge Union Debating Society and the author of several books. Her husband, Michael Huffington, lost a close race for the Senate in California last year in which immigration was a major issue. Mrs. Huffington's current project is a new TV show called Beat the Press. And I can't tell you how many journalists are already starting to fantasize about being beaten by Arianna Huffington. Daniel Stein is executive director of the Federation for American Immigration Reform, or FAIR. FAIR is the leading lobbying group for new limits on immigration. Mr. Stein was born in Washington, D.C., and in the current political climate, I don't know if that makes you a native-born American or not. According to his resume, and I was struck by this, and I quote, he plays trombone and enjoys a full range of hobbies and interests. I guess that's what you call tooting your own horn. The captain of the opposition team is our host today, the president of Bard College, Leon Botstein. Mr. Botstein is also music director of the American Symphony Orchestra. That means he doesn't have to toot his own horn. He has an entire horn section to toot for him. He's the author of several books on music and on European cultural history. Mr. Botstein was born in Switzerland of Jewish refugee parents and emigrated to this country at the age of three. Ed Koch, of course, is the former three-term mayor of New York City. He was born in the Bronx. In retirement, Mr. Koch is partner in a law firm, has his own radio talk show, is host of a talk television show, writes a weekly column for the New York Post, writes a syndicated column of movie reviews, and lectures around the country. It seems to me that Mr. Koch, all by himself, is stealing more jobs from Americans than any number of illegal aliens. Our old friend Ira Glasser is executive director of the American Civil Liberties Union. He was born in Brooklyn, I believe. Now, Mr. Glasser may or may not play the trombone. His resume does not say, and of course, he has a constitutional right to remain silent on that point. I would merely say that if he does by any chance play the trombone, his trombone has both the right and the duty to remain silent tonight. That goes for Mr. Stein's trombone and also for Mr. Buckley's harpsichord. No music. Frank Sharry is executive director of the National Immigration Forum, which is America's leading pro-immigration lobbying group. He was active in the unsuccessful campaign against California's Proposition 187. Mr. Sherry's resume also does not indicate whether or not he plays the trombone. It does say, however, he speaks Spanish, which is reasonable enough in his line of work, but I believe he may speak English as well, or at least we'll find out. So those are tonight's debaters. I wield the gavel tonight. My name is Mike Kinsley, and I now call upon Mr. Buckley to propose tonight's motion. Mr. Buckley.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, the subject we're debating tonight begs to be mishandled by the affirmative, those of us who believe immigration should be curbed and poisoned by the negative, those who urge no changes in immigration policy. The reason this is so is that we have here before the House a question of public policy in which the great intimacies of ethnic pride are involved. If the subject under discussion were whether to lessen the tariff barriers or raise them, we would only marginally touch on human sensitivities. The great shadow that looms menacingly over one side is rank nativism, to stumble into saying, that man who wants to get into the United States is black, brown, or yellow, and we have enough of them. On the other side, the allurements are a composite. There are the libertarians who say anybody who wants to do anything should be permitted to do so. And if one of the things people want to do is come to live in the United States, why not? That is one of the great disabling rhetorical limbs that get in the way of clear thought. Another holds that inasmuch as everyone in America is the child or great-grandchild of an immigrant, what reason can there be for adopting different policies from those that let us or our forebears in? There will be data given on these points as they arise. For instance, it is simply not the case that immigration on the scale in which it now proceeds is conventional in American history. And it isn't the case that the ebb and flow of human beings into, or for that matter, out of one country into another, are mechanical questions to be governed simply by the laws of arbitrage. These particulars my colleagues will confront as required in the discussion. I mean to touch on the touchiest of all questions in the hope, probably fruitless, that polemical opportunism will be restrained. I think it is a legitimate concern of a country, ours especially. We have been taking in, year after year, 50% of all immigrants in the entire world to give thought to the culture and ethos we hope to preserve. What this comes down to is a question of assimilation. The ideal of immigration is not alone to provide shelter or even economic opportunity, but to create another American. Now, to say any such thing these days in the firestorm of multiculturalism is to court criticism that can be mortal, especially in academic salons. But recall that it was not so long ago taken for granted that anyone coming to America would need to learn something about American institutions and would need, if he hoped to vote, to read and write in English. That isn't the case anymore. In New York City schools, we learn courses are taught in 100 languages, and there's a shortage of teachers who can speak Albanian. The questions that were brought on, the pressures that were brought on immigrants, so to speak, pressures to Americanize them, were so direct that during the last half of the 19th century, one-third of immigrants simply gave up, and after a while traveled back home. Immigrants were required just to begin with to make their own way economically. That is no longer true under the welfare state, and were required to learn the language of American English, no longer required. Those were the most conspicuous forces of socialization, but there were others designed to communicate an ethos. One of them, of course, was the discipline of self-government. Self-government is very rare, and in the 19th century, something of an eccentricity. And then to the ethos in America, presumed religious convictions. 98% of America at the time of the Revolutionary War was Protestant. It is our contention that America, the most successful engine of assimilation in the history of the world, hasn't got the steam needed to handle immigration at the current level, and that the burden of assimilation became more acute when in 1965 the qualifications for immigration changed so radically. Does this mean that it is more difficult to assimilate Haitians and Mexicans than British and Italians? Yes. We're prepared to go that far, wistfully hoping that this is not to earn a denunciation as racists. We really should be permitted to speak about such matters without risking the charge of un-Americanism. Why should Pennsylvania, founded by the English, become a colony of aliens who will shortly be so numerous as to Germanize us instead of our anglifying them? The person who spoke those words was Benjamin Franklin. And Mr. Chairman, we will bear bravely any charge leveled against us that could also be leveled against Benjamin Franklin. He thought it entirely civilized to speak about the ethnic characteristics of other countries. We do believe that there is something there when we speak of American exceptionalism. This doesn't bind us to disdain the cultural claims of others. We listen with respect to someone asserting the relative achievements of the Swiss or the Spanish or the Swedes, though we might get restless listening to the claims of some nationalists best quarantined in the United Nations. We no need here tonight to document American exceptionalism. We need only to document that more is being expected of this country than it can reasonably be expected to furnish, while still surviving as the country to whose health and prosperity we are committed. Ladies and gentlemen, let's drink to that.
Mr. President Botstein is invited up to oppose the motion.
Today's debate is an experience in déjà vu. We've heard the same refrains before: too many bad, different, new immigrants, as opposed to fewer good, old-style immigrants, that we can't afford immigration altogether. Is this any different from the predictions of doom expressed by, yes, Ben Franklin, about Germans in Pennsylvania, Republicans in 1896 who wanted a literacy test, Henry Cabot Lodge's derision of Italians as worse than the Irish, and the misguided Immigration Commission of 1911, when immigration reached an all-time high, which predicted that new immigrants would either compete for jobs or ruin the fabric of America? They were wrong. So why are today's naysayers, with the same arguments, suddenly right? Immigration in our past had been more statistically significant than it is now. Almost 15% of the population in 1910 was foreign-born. Today, only 8% is. Since the first census in 1790, the percent of immigrants has been unusually high, and America flourished economically and culturally. And there are only a million immigrants coming in a year, not two. Today's immigrants won't behave any differently from our forefathers and foremothers. A century ago, there were public and private schools in the rural Midwest teaching only German, yet by the second and third generation, English triumphed. Second-generation Spanish speakers in Florida are showing the same pattern: loss of ancestral language toward proficiency in English. Even intermarriage rates show their classic upward trend. All previous generations of immigrants and their children had high rates of school dropout, illness, poverty, and crime. We were warned that the masses of foreigners on the Lower East Side would never enter the mainstream and would corrupt American mores. And yet the transition to the middle class took place. So too today. Just look at the Korean grocery markets in New York. Do our opponents really believe that our global economy, with its ease and speed of travel, that we can stop immigration? We get 19 million visitors a year. Even Britain, a more homogeneous and traditional island culture, has an immigration problem. Sealing the borders is a pipe dream. So the question is rather how we can manage immigration better, simplify it, encourage legal rather than illegal immigration. We are not the French and not the Japanese. Our culture, like our language, is the evolving consequence of sustained immigration. Our opponents, proud conservatives, seem to favor free trade and markets without regulation for everything but people. Why should we not be able to hire the best engineer from anywhere, just as we're free to buy the best TV set, even if it's foreign? Look how much American science industry and our universities profited from the intellectual migration of the 1930s. The poor from over the Mexican border come because they will work where and when others won't. Sure, immigrants cost money, but they also fill jobs, and they fuel the economy. The Zoe Baird problem is a matter of demand. We should encourage skilled immigration, regulate unskilled immigration according to demand, and preserve America as a refuge from political and religious persecution. Immigration will remain the unique factor behind America's greatness as a competitive and different nation, not characterized by a rigid, jingoist, and racist view of itself.
Mr. Brimelow and Mr. Sharry, it's your opportunity to ascend to the podium, Mr. Sharry and Mr. Brimelow. And Mr. Brimelow has a minute and a half to make an opening statement.
Do I start now, Mike?
Start now.
Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to start off by thanking, saying that I'm here courtesy of my wife and Dr. James Sussman, who is delivering her, Dr. John Sussman, who is delivering of a baby right about now. But Bill Buckley called, so I had to come. And that's appropriate, really, because immigration is typically a policy where A and B get together. We have A and B and C here and decide what C should do for D. C in this case is our children. Our children have been asked to decide. I've been asked to handle the consequence of these decisions which are being made now. Immigration is out of control, both illegal immigration and legal immigration. Legal immigration because of the peculiar workings of the 1965 Act. We must never forget that this is a policy, a government policy, and it works in very paradoxical ways. The US is being transformed against its will, as measured by opinion polls, by accident, to no economic advantage whatever, a thing which I spend a great deal of time on, alien nation, and the American people haven't been asked. There has never been a transformation like this in the history of the world. We're not saying that it won't necessarily work, but we're saying that it's a risk, and the American people should be asked whether they want to take that risk. We should have a pause in immigration precisely to allow that great debate to take place and to allow the immigration policy to be reformed on some rational basis.
Thank you, Mr. Brimelow. Mr. Sharry, you have a minute and a half.
Immigration is a very highly charged debate, very emotional, I think really because it gets down to the question of who we are as a nation, as President Botstein so eloquently addressed. We also need a rational debate about immigration. We need to look at the facts and figures rather than the myths and misinformation that this debate is steeped in. For example, most international migrants in the world do not come to the United States. In fact, less than 1% come to the United States. Most stay in the developing world. And of those immigrants and refugees who come to the United States, the vast majority come in perfectly legally after going through a highly regulated system. In fact, 85% of the immigrants and refugees living in the United States reside here legally. The numbers. We will hear a lot of scary numbers about the zillions of people overrunning the United States. The fact is, legal and illegal immigration comprises about 8% of the U.S. population. From 1850 through 1940, that percentage as a share of population was up in the neighborhood of 15%. The United States has dealt with far greater proportional immigration than we are dealing with this decade. The economic impacts, economists from across the spectrum, from right to left, agree that on balance and over time, immigrants contribute more than they take. Starting businesses through their production, through their consumption, hardworking, tax-paying folks who, after being in the country for 10 years, have a higher household income than people born in the United States. Immigrants are assimilating quickly. There are lotteries for adult ESL, English as a Second Language classes. Kids of immigrants not only learn English, but prefer English. The fact is that we need a sensible debate in which we look at the facts. And when we do that, then the policy debate will be a lot easier to handle.
Thank you, Mr. Sharry. Don't go away. It's your chance to interrogate Mr. Brimelow.
Mr. Brimelow, in your book, Alien Nation, you make the statement that race is destiny. Can you explain what you mean by that?
Yes, I didn't make that statement, Frank, as you perfectly well know, because we've been through this many times before. What I said was, race is destiny in American politics. And that goes to a difference between American politics and European politics. European politics political allegiance is determined by class. In American politics, political allegiance is determined by race and ethnicity. And what that means is that where you alter the ethnic balance of the country, you are in effect altering its political future. I mean, there is no way that Jesse Jackson is going to be elected president of this country unless the Rainbow Coalition grows to the point where it can basically, putting it crudely, outvote the whites. And of course, with the policy where that you recommend, that is going to happen.
Well, what about the fact that the largest proportional growth of immigration is coming from Asia? And in fact, the Asian community is very supportive of the Republican Party. In fact, most foreign-born Asians vote Asian-born immigrants vote Republican than Democrat. So how can you say that race is destiny in American politics? And upwards of 40% of Hispanics vote Republican as well. It seems to me that both of those major new groups of immigrants are up for grabs politically. So how can you say...
That appears to me to mean, Frank, that 60% of Hispanics vote Democratic. And
that's also true.
But that's
the fact
a substantial
is that
number.
How can race be destiny in American politics, major groups are up for grabs?
I don't agree that they are. I mean, it's quite clear that Hispanics are predominantly a Democratic group, although, of course, it's a very variegated category, Hispanic. It's not really a very good analytical category. Asians, we just don't have any numbers on. Less than 1% of them voted in the presidential election last year. So we just really don't know what they're going to do. But of course, what you're doing here is conceding my point, which is that these groups do differ systematically from the rest of the population according to ethnicity. And therefore, by controlling the ethnic inflow in one way or another, you are going to alter the future of American politics. And the question is why?
Well, it seems to me that my conception of America is that we need to be as strong and as confident and as optimistic as we've been up until now in order to keep growing. That we've gotten here by not only taking risks, but by embracing an incredible amount of diversity, people from different faiths and different backgrounds and different nationalities, and carved out a very strong democracy in the most powerful nation in the world. Why, given the historical evidence of the benefits of immigration, why now is it too much of a risk to take?
What's characterized American immigration in the past is not this. It's not continuous. There are pauses. Some of these pauses extend for a very long time. In the middle of this century, there's a pause of 40 years. After the Revolution, there was a pause of 50 years. When Ben Franklin complained about Germans, the German immigration collapsed, and it didn't resume again for nearly 100 years. Those pauses are essential to the process of assimilation. No pauses are in sight now, naturally, because of the demographic structure of the Third World. One will have to be legislated, as it was in the 1920s.
In your book, you mention that we are attracting most immigrants from the Third World, that they are, quote, visible minorities, that INS waiting rooms look like New York subways, and that you seem to be disturbed by the skin color of immigrants rather than the content of their character. And I was wondering if you could respond to that.
I've said repeatedly in the book, I don't know if I have to tattoo it on my head, that I'm confident that the American assimilative mechanism can assimilate anybody. They could assimilate Martians here. But they can't do it without a pause. It also helps if the Martians are skilled. And one of the key criticisms of the 1965 Immigration Act is that it skewed the skill levels downwards, so that for the first time we see an immigrant inflow which is less skilled than the American native born on average, which in turn is why immigrants are 9% on welfare as opposed to Americans, native born Americans 7% and native born American whites 5%.
Well, as in your book, you seem to settle for distortions of the fact. As you would know very well, that is only half the story. We are attracting some unskilled immigrants, and we are attracting a tremendous number of skilled immigrants. 40% of the engineers in Silicon Valley, one of the most high-growth areas in the United States, are foreign-born. Many, many small businesses, which is the engine of growth in this country, are immigrant entrepreneurs. Many of the foreign trade and export-oriented industries that are such a motor.
This is a question, Frank.
Yes, it is. So given those facts, in your study, have you in fact concluded that immigration does not create economic growth, does not boost the economy of the United States for all of us?
First of all, there's a consensus among economists that immigration is not necessary for economic growth. It does nothing that Americans couldn't do for themselves by other institutional means. Economic growth has actually slowed down since before the Act. 15 years before 1965, immigration was economic growth was faster than it was afterwards.
Okay, you can go on the offensive when you're through.
Oh, thank you. The best estimate of the economic advantage of immigration, the benefit of immigration to the native-born, is by Professor George Boas at UC San Diego, who wrote the review article in the Journal of Economic Literature last year. And his estimate is that the benefit to the native-born right now is about 0.1% of GDP. It's actually wiped out by the welfare loss, which he estimates about $15 billion. Are you familiar with this study?
I am familiar with his study, and Mr. Borjas is always cited by the restrictionists, I believe, because he's the one legitimate economist that sort of supports your view. In survey after survey, economists from across the spectrum of Nobel laureates in this century, they were asked, is immigration a benefit or not? 81% said yes, and the other 19% said somewhat. Not one of them said it was negative.
But you must realize that Nobel laureate economists often vote Democratic.
Well, I also realize that the Bush administration Department of Labor did really the definitive analysis of labor market impacts and concluded that on balance and over time, immigration creates economic growth. You have conceded that this really isn't an issue about
you're aware that in my book I quoted Professor Julian Simon, who is supposed to be the leading expert on your side, saying frankly that he's never said that immigration is necessary to economic growth.
I believe, Mr. Brimelow, the questions are now in your hands.
That is a question.
That is a question?
Are you aware of that?
I am not aware of that, no.
Oh, dear.
I don't pray
you know,
at Julian Simon's church.
The census... The Census Bureau, are you aware that the Census Bureau projects that without immigration, the U.S. population is going to stabilize at around 250, 260 million because Americans of all races are bringing down their family sizes. But with immigration, it will go up to in 2050 to around 390 million. And that's their middle series projection. Their high series is 500 million. Now, the question I want to ask you here is, why do you want to second guess the American people on population size?
I'm not second-guessing. I mean, I don't see population growth in and of itself as a bad thing. The United States has modest population growth by international standards. I am concerned about population growth where it is more out of control, but fertility rates have come down all over the world, and particularly in the United States.
I don't
see it as a problem. If you're getting at the environmental question, which I find interesting for a conservative like yourself,
I'm open-minded.
You're open-minded. Now you're an environmentalist when it comes to immigration. It's very interesting, this kind of drug pushing that restrictionists do. It's like, what do you got? You got a problem? You're concerned about the environment? Here's the drug. Take this blame immigrant drug and you'll feel better. Worried about schools? Worried about culture?
What I want to know is why do you want to drive the population up to 390 million when without immigration it will stabilize at 250 million?
You're asking me like it's a problem. I don't see population growth.
No, I want to know why do you want to increase the population?
I don't want to drive population growth. These projections have changed every year in the past 5 years based on a current
snapshot.
They've
all gone upwards.
No, they haven't. In fact, 2 years ago they said population would stabilize in the middle of next century with immigration. So we can expect those projections to change with the wind and with differences in policies. If you're concerned about the environmental impact, we should talk about consumption habits of Americans. Let's not talk about immigrants who come and recycle. Let's talk about, in the United States, consuming more than 25% of the world's resources with 6% of the population. If you want to address environmental concerns, I'm happy to. Just don't blame immigrants in the process.
Just keep going. You've got another minute and a half.
Do you mean you're not going to answer the question of why you want to drive up the population to food?
Yeah, I have answered it. I'm not concerned about population growth in the United States. I am concerned about population growth in third world countries where the fertility rates are in the six to seven per couple. In the United States, it's 2.1, just a bit above replacement level. And I would prefer to be a young, dynamic country with lots of people being born in this country and lots of opportunity as opposed to Europe, your hallowed ground, where population growth is below replacement level, where you have an aging population, and where the world is not looking for new ideas. I would prefer to have the United States be the dynamic, robust, confident country that it's always been, in large part fueled by immigration.
Okay, I take that to mean that you are in favor. I take that to mean that you are in favor of increasing the American population so radically. As you know, for more than 40 years, not more than 13% of Americans, 1-3%, have said they're in favor of increasing immigration. But in that period, immigration has quintupled. Now, the question is, why shouldn't the American people be allowed to have their way on this? If they want immigration reform, why can't they have it?
Let me address the proposition. You like to talk about how legal immigration needs to be reduced, and I fundamentally reject that. I do believe that illegal immigration needs to be reduced. There is a big difference.
What about the American people and their opinions?
The American people believe that most immigrants are coming in illegally, and they're badly misinformed, and I believe too many have read your book, and as a result, they are misinformed.
All right. Thank you both. Thank you both. Arianna Huffington has an opportunity to make a short opening statement and then submit to the interrogation of the opposing team.
I want to begin by addressing the apparent irony of somebody with my clear immigrant accent being on this side of the debate. I arrived in this country 15 years before the 1965 Immigration Act and became a citizen in 1990. And what really changed my mind was what happened to me in the last year when I traveled around California and talked not to former mayors and to college presidents and to think tank heads, but to real Americans who are being affected by the who are being affected by the high numbers of legal and illegal immigration. I remember talking to a couple, a black couple near San Diego. They're making, together, less than $30,000 a year. And they were wondering, why should they be paying? Why should their hard-earned taxpayer dollars go to pay for illegal immigrants on welfare? So what dawned on me was that the America into which the immigrants arrive today is a very different America than the America of the past. The last 30 years of bankrupt welfare policies, the tragedy of bilingual education and multicultural experiments, have turned America into a nation in crisis, incapable of absorbing and assimilating high numbers of immigrants wherever they come from. My problem is not where they come from, Peter, whether they are white or black or Asian. My problem is that the explosive mixture today is the welfare society together with high levels of immigration. And what I'm arguing here tonight is that until we dismantle the welfare state, until we dismantle bilingual education, until we dismantle multicultural experiments, we need to drastically reduce the high levels of immigration.
All right. Mr. Glasser.
Ms. Huffington, some people on your side, notably Mr. Brimelow, would support the reimposition of national origin quotas to restore our population balance to what he in his book calls the pre-1965 levels, around 90% white. It is impossible, I notice him nodding now, but that's because the people in the audience can't read his book. But it is impossible to read that book without repeatedly seeing it. Why don't you hand it to me and I'll get you the page. What I wanted to know from you is, do you support the reimposition of national origin quotas that would change the composition of who comes into the country as distinct from the absolute numbers?
No, A, I don't support it, and B, I think it has nothing to do with the resolution today. The resolution is about drastic reductions to the numbers of immigrants coming to this country. The resolution says nothing about ethnic origin, nothing about color, and this is just a red herring on your side of the debate.
I didn't write the book.
No, but you're asking questions which are not about the resolution. We are not here to debate Peter Brimelow's book.
But the question,
we are here to debate whether there should be drastic reductions in immigration.
Whether or not the calls for the drastic reduction of size are a pretext for the change in composition. Now, you want to talk about that. We keep being told by your side, we want to talk about this. We want to put it on the table, and we don't want to be called racist for doing so. Well, I'm not calling anybody a racist. I'm just putting it on the table. You put it there. Now you don't want to talk about it.
No, no, no. Well, I want to talk about the resolution on the table today. And what I'm saying is that there is such a thing as an American identity, but it has nothing to do with ethnic origin and nothing to do with color. But there is such a thing as an American identity, and that's why it's important to assimilate immigrants so that they become part of the American identity. I don't care what Americans are going to look like in the year 2050. I don't care if they look more like Mr. Buckley and Mr. Brimelow, handsome men than they are, or if they look darker or whatever. What I care about
like
is
me,
what
right?
Americans are going to be like in the year 2050.
Mr. Botstein.
You made the assertion that you believe that the process of assimilation is not happening. Are you aware of the fact that in the 19th century, the American identity was shaped by a very gradual loss of language, and that loss of language is happening now by studies done about the shift from ancestral language to current language? You make the assertion, without any factual basis at all, that in fact There is no assimilation happening, when there, in fact, is enormous assimilation, not to speak of the fact that American identity today, look at the advertising language, is a result of immigration, Jewish, Italian, and Irish. So it's a fluctuating identity to begin with.
Then why are so many official forms printed in hundreds of languages? Why is the LA educational system teaching not only Spanish, not only Japanese, not only Russian, but a language called Tagalog, which I don't know what it is, but maybe you do.
Yes,
American children, and indeed Hispanic children, being deprived of the opportunity to learn English and be part of the mainstream?
They're not being deprived. Immigrant populations for generations were taught German, Polish. Today, in this day in Chicago, you can go to Polish neighborhoods in Chicago and see the level of Polish is not that admirable, the continuing use of Polish. What I'm suggesting is that there were newspapers and schools in the history of America doing exactly what's happening
now. But
they
were being taught by their parents, by their schools.
By public schools in rural Midwest in the 19th century, there was exclusively German taught.
You need to go to Los Angeles and talk to the people who are leading the movement against bilingual education.
Because there's been a racism against immigrants in this country from the very beginning.
Mr. Carr.
The people who come in don't want the next person to come in after them.
Just stop name-calling and argue the facts.
Mr. Koch.
Arianna, I'm an admirer of yours, but not on this issue, but on many others. And I believe that the emphasis that you give is misplaced. Why blame the immigrants for the stupidities of some educators in this country? Why? Comes here and says, I don't want to learn in English. That's not what the. I just want to finish the question.
People like Leon Botstein.
I might agree with that. I am saying, don't keep the immigrants out.
Keep Leon
out. The educators out.
Let her answer.
The multiculturalism, that wasn't brought here by the Chinese or blacks or Hispanics. That was imposed upon them.
I'm not even arguing it.
That is exactly the point I made.
Get rid of the multiculturalism, not the immigrants.
Too much agreement here. Time to move on. Thank you.
Until we get rid of multiculturalism, we cannot afford to have the high levels of present immigration.
Thank you, Mrs. Huffington. Mr. Glasser. Your opportunity to make an opening statement and then be interrogated by the proponents of the resolution.
The talk about numbers is pretextual. It is over-exaggerated in the extreme. The number of immigrants who come in, including illegals, each year now is at about 1 million. If the present commission's recommendations has its way, it'll be cut by about 1/3. That's 1 million against some 258 million people, a very small percentage. We had 1 million coming in 1910. That was against a population of 90 million, a much larger percentage. The numbers are simply not that big. They aren't. It's grossly exaggerated. The economic consequences are marginal. Most economists, including the conservative Julian Simon, says that if we have fewer immigrants, we will be poorer. We will have a larger federal deficit. We will have a worse position of international competition. He says flatly, and said so to Mr. Brimelow in a debate recently, that if we can reduce the number of immigrants if we want, but we will make American citizens poorer, that the higher level is better for us economically. Even Professor Borjas, who is your side's favorite, says that the economic issues are at best indecisive. Mr. Brimelow says that repeatedly in his book and says we have to go to something else. The something else is the nature of the American character, and we want to keep it the way it was before 1965. Now, what does that mean exactly? If it doesn't mean numbers and it doesn't mean economic consequences, what does it mean?
Someone want to take that up? Mr. Stein.
Does the ACLU have any objection to the American people if they choose to bringing the immigration level down to zero?
We do not.
And would you explain to the American people how the Native American benefited from immigration 400 years ago.
There's a really interesting thing that happens here. First, Mr. Brimelow did it, now you do it. You seem to have a divine way of figuring out what the American people mean. And it certainly isn't what Congress did. No. Congress is not what the American people meant. You know what the American people want. Tell me what it is that you're talking about. I'm talking about Congress reducing it down to zero, Ira.
Now, how did the Native American benefit from immigration? Would you describe that for us?
The Native Americans did not benefit from immigration. They did not benefit from Mr. Brimelow's ancestors, who, as I recall, we threw out because they didn't understand American traditions. They did not benefit from decimation and genocide either. But that's not what we're talking about, is it? If you want to stick to the germane principle, why did you even ask that question?
Because, as even Julian Simon points out, there are various groups, particularly those on the bottom of the labor market, who are more disproportionately affected by the depression on wage rates and labor competition in hotel, restaurant, service works. No, I'm talking about Americans with a high school degree or less. And I think the evidence is clear that if you look at the standard of living and the average wages of Americans with a high school degree or less since immigration's been going up since 1980, surely the ACLU must be concerned about their wage rates.
We are. And the fact is that it's not affected by the levels of immigration. And Professor Borjas says that, and Professor Simon says it, and it's marginal at best. You're talking here about dueling economists, all of whom agree that the differences are small. So why is this big debate? What is this big debate about? And the big debate about, which you want to run away from, is that we did something in 1965, but it was more than just the numbers, because the 65 legislation left the numbers where they were at the time. What it did is it changed the American character. And I would like somebody on this side of the panel to tell me, what do you mean by that?
Mrs. Huffington.
Lucas Goodentag, who is a lawyer with ACLU,
still is.
Maybe he won't be after you hear what he said.
Oh,
but he.
I think I know more about what he says than you do. But go ahead.
But he said that all this talk about immigration is pandering to Americans' most primitive fears. Now, this is the kind of condescending statement that American people are tired of. And when you question Mr. Stein's numbers, every poll taken shows 2/3 of the American people in favor of reducing illegal immigration, and indeed legal immigration. Look at the results of Proposition 187.
Let me tell you something about the American people.
4 million people and a half.
Since you're an immigrant yourself, let me tell you something about the American people in polls. In 1950, all the polls showed that they were in favor of segregation too, didn't they? The American people, in terms of what the polls show, is not the way we do business in this country.
It hasn't got to do with
the facts necessarily, does it?
Okay,
it
so
has
you don't
to do
believe...
with what I'm saying to you is that if the economic consequences are marginal, and if the numbers are by historical standards not that big, and if what you all keep saying is that we're changing the American character because of something we did in 65. Tell me what you mean by that.
Okay.
I notice now nobody wants to do that.
Mr. Brimelow.
Mr. Glasser, you must realize that you've walked into Dan's trap here. He was asking you about the effect of immigration on the native-born Americans. The point there is precisely, surely, that it can radically alter a society. And it
yes,
did
if
alter.
You kill them all, that's true.
I see.
That's true. If you let them open up businesses and have economic mobility, it's less true, as most of us in this room are evident.
Are you aware that immigrants, on average, are less likely to open up businesses than the native-born?
I am not aware of that.
Good.
Because it isn't true.
Are you
true.
Aware of the... It is
it
true.
True.
It is true. It shows
no,
up in the census.
No, it is not true.
You really must read my book,
Alien Nation. Oh, I have. I
Alien
have,
Nation, Random
I
House,
have,
$24.
And I used up all my supply of Alka-Seltzer after I did. Your book,
I'm
Mr.
Delighted,
Brimelow...
I'm delighted to hear that.
Book,
you must read it again.
Your book was characterized by your favorite economist, Julian Simon, as suffused by race. Your book and every other page worries about your little son, Alexander, growing up in a world which is non-white. Your book characterizes non-white immigrants as typified by Colin Ferguson. Your book worries about going down into the subway where it is almost people are almost entirely colored.
Let me ask you. Let me ask you a question.
Who use the subway every day.
What is your agenda? What is your agenda here? Why do you want to transform America?
My agenda is exposing you.
Why do you want to transform America?
My agenda is exposing you.
Thank you both. You won't get another crack. This is Mr. Stein's opportunity to make an opening statement.
Thank you. Barbara Jordan, her commission, appointed by President Clinton and Congress, has recommended major cuts in immigration. Now, there's a reason why. Polls show, and I think it's pretty clear from public opinion otherwise, that the American people want to see cuts in immigration. Now, there are only three questions we have to deal with when we look into the future on this issue. How many people we're going to admit, who are they going to be, and how can we better enforce the rules to make sure that all immigrants are legal? We also have to ask a more fundamental question, which is, why do we need immigration at this point in our national history? As Peter has mentioned, there have been long and sustained pauses. We used immigration to fill up a continent. Very low levels compared to today, but we did with the Northwest Territories and the Northwest Ordinance Act of 1787. We pushed people across the continent, the wilderness, as against contending colonial powers to build a nation with a template of institutions and cultural ideas that were able to help absorb people as they moved across the land. We had one brief period where we had an extraordinarily high rate of immigration around the turn of the century for the Industrial Revolution to mine the coal and to build the railroads. But throughout most of this century and during those periods of very high economic growth, we've had very low immigration. Now we have very high immigration, going to increase our population to 400 million in many of our lifetimes, and we haven't asked ourselves, why do we need immigration? What's its purpose? And how can we better make the policies that we have today fit our own domestic set of objectives and needs?
Thank you. Mr. Botstein.
Just a factual matter. John Higham, in his book on the immigrant American history, shows that the rates of immigration from 1790 to 1940 were at 10% to 9%, approximately current levels. What's this nonsense about there being only high for one period in American history?
Throughout most of the colonial period, immigration rarely exceeded 5,000 a year.
Let me ask you another
question. The second guy off the Mayflower increased our foreign-born population by 100%. Yeah. So obviously, as your base population gets larger,
you've forgotten to take a census of the Native American Indian. But let me ask you another question. Talking about the attitude of America, in 1933, if you had given a poll of Americans whether they should open the doors, or in the late 30s, 1938, to the Jews of Europe, would you have thought that was an adequate answer, that they didn't want more Jews in the United States, and therefore our restrictive quota policy led indirectly to the death of millions of Jews?
This is called the St. Louis Gambit.
The suggestion is
that we should have moved 6
million people. I'm a descendant of one of the few survivors.
Well, but the point is that at that point in time, or even today, we cannot accept everyone who wants to come here. And if you have to have a totally cavalier attitude about what the public thinks on this issue or any issue, or to say, well, democracy doesn't matter, polls don't matter, there is a very clear increase in intensity of public concern about this issue. And if you let the ivory tower inside the Beltway eggheads decide how many people come in without regard to its impact on schools and hospitals and the labor market and all the highly impacted areas, you're asking for trouble.
Who are those
Mr. Sharry?
You're the only one who lives in Washington.
Pardon me? Mr. Sharry.
Mr. Stein, your group calls for a moratorium on immigration,
essentially
zero immigration policies, as I understand it, much like the far-right parties in Europe. How, since immigration policy is based on reunifying husbands, wives, children, brothers, sisters,
uncles, aunts,
that's not true. You know that. You know that's not true.
Don't
misinform the American people. It does not. The siblings is the most extended category, and waiting lists are 18 years.
You're eating up my time.
You know, let's just get the facts straight so we can have a sensible debate. Now, families won't be reunited, refugees won't be rescued, and American businesses won't be able to attract the kind of skilled international personnel they need. Does that serve American national interests?
That's not a characterization of what our immigration policy is. About 90% of immigrants come simply because a relative came earlier. And many relatives who come today are relatives of relatives through the petitioning process. Look, if you look at our chromosomes, hey, we're all related if you go back far enough. And it's like at some point you have
to use a rational, we've got to ask the basic question,
what's the purpose of immigration? Are we trying to fill up a continent? Are we underpopulated? Is there not enough traffic, not enough congestion? I mean, we don't have immigration as a national need. In the way that we once did as a young, thriving nation, immigration is not serving any key and major national interest objectives. And that's why we're going to have this extraordinarily important national debate.
Strengthening families is a national
debate.
Mr. Koch.
Dan, when you said a moment ago, uncles and aunts, and you know that that's not true, and then you don't respond to his inquiry on that, isn't that why the people in this country believe that immigration is out of control because people like you have given them false information?
I have given
nothing. That's number one.
Well, let me answer the question.
Because
all right, If I come in as an immigrant, I can bring in immediately my spouse and my minor children. After I become a citizen, I can bring my parent and my married brothers and sisters. This is what the commission's looking at, my married brothers and sisters and my married adult sons and daughters. When my parent comes in, he or she, when she becomes a citizen, can bring in her brother or sister. That's my uncle and aunt. Now, why are you telling me that that's not the case when it is, Ed?
Your mother may bring in her brother, but you can't bring in your uncle. Now, I want to give you the second question.
Zingo.
The second question is this. You and many of your colleagues on that side seem to say, well, the American people have decided that they want to end or limit immigration, and why is it they don't get their way? Now, I served in the Congress for 9 years, and the form of government that we have is that representatives go to Congress to vote as they think is in the best interest, and if they then vote in ways that the public thinks is not in their best interest, they throw them out. But there is no suggestion amongst the members of Congress or the voters in the district that I used to represent that I am simply there to push a lever based upon a referendum or a poll. And I am simply saying that to say that the public wants this, the public wants, regrettably, on many occasions, that which the demagogues have urged them to demand. And it's wonderful when people stand up and say, this I will do, this I will not. If you don't like it, throw me out.
All right. That's why we have elections. Fortunately, we have in both the House and the Senate, we have two committee chairs in the immigration subcommittees who think we need to cut immigration, that being the issue on the agenda. What's wrong with a timeout or a pause? Like we've had many times in our history, you have a wave of immigration, then you have a pause to absorb and assimilate. What is wrong with that?
It's a rhetorical question. Thank you very much, Mr. Stein. Mr. Carr. It's your chance to make an opening statement. You're up.
I come to this forum with a bias. My parents were immigrants. They came here in the early 1900s, and they had three children, and one of them became the mayor of the city of New York. I think that we all congratulate Peter Brimelow on the fact that his wife and he are going to have a child momentarily to be born. And I hope that that child someday could be the mayor or the governor of whatever town you're living in.
In what country you're living in at that point.
But I say to myself, it's a travesty. Here you are. You came here as an immigrant. Your wife came here as an immigrant. Your son or daughter is going to have all of what this country can give, and you have the effrontery in your book to say not only that this has got to stop, but there was, I believe, a statement saying that Hitler got his revenge in this period through the immigration situation that we have in the United States. I think that's a travesty. That's an outrage to suggest that what we have in the United States and having brought in the millions from Southern Europe as well as Northern Europe, that that's a travesty. Then finally, as I said to you, Arianna, I'm a great admirer, but they wanted to keep out the Greeks in 1924. And had you come at that earlier time, we wouldn't have had the privilege and pleasure of meeting you.
All right, thank you, Mr. Brimelow. Don't go away, Mr. Brimelow.
Mr. Mayor, doesn't it occur to you that it's precisely because the immigrant inflow got so large in the 1900s and politicians then would not respond to Americans' distress over the question, that the Americans became so overwrought that their cutoff was so ruthless that they were unable to allow Jews in?
You know, Ira said a moment ago, I want the American people to have whatever it is that they get their representatives to vote for. And if they're successful in ultimately cutting off immigration which I hope will not be the case. I will be upset personally, but I won't denounce America in that
sense. Doesn't it occur to you that, surely you recognize that the reason why I describe the 1965 Act as Hitler's revenge is because it's the hysteria, the anti-racist hysteria that prevails since then, as we see exemplified by Leon and Ira here, is so great that we can't have a rational discussion on the question.
But you see, Peter, when you say we can't have rational discussion, it is because you know that it's just unacceptable to take a position that the reason that you don't want our immigration law is that it's bringing in too many blacks, it's bringing in too many Hispanics, it's bringing in too many Asians. And in fact, that is the argument that you give, that these people will not be acculturated. They won't. They in fact, will if you give them the opportunity.
And a pause.
No, I don't think the pause has any. That pause is baloney. What I am saying, is there are lots of laws in this country, and there are lots of bureaucrats and educators who are, in particularly the multiculturalists, who are your allies. Because what they're doing to the excesses that they're engaged in are making it possible for people like you to go even further in your language.
Don't
your
you realize that it's because
your book
of the.
And here is reprehensible.
Don't you realize that under the workings of the 1965 Act, your grandparents couldn't have gotten here anyway because it has, in fact, choked off immigration from Eastern Europe?
Well, I mean, I, if that's true, I would.
What do you mean, if it's true? Don't you know?
What's that?
I said, what do you mean, if it's true, don't you know?
That my grandparents couldn't come here after 1965?
No, no, no. The 65 Act has choked off immigration from Europe.
Let me just say this to you.
The 24 Act choked.
I am proud of the fact that the immigrants, of which my mother and father were two, contributed an enormous amount to this country. I hope that you and your wife contribute as much as they did.
All right, Mr. Butler.
Contributed the book.
Mayor Koch, a moment ago, one of your colleagues cited 1933. Are we supposed to be abject in our in our contrition for not having then welcomed the Jewish population of Germany? Two observations. Number one, nobody, including the Jewish population, knew what was in store for them. Number two, to attempt this kind of preemptive prophetic act commits America to doing things which I think even you would argue we can't do. Should we admit a million Rwandans tomorrow? Should we have admitted a million Cambodians after the bombing in 1970? This asks us to make exertions which are simply surrealistic.
Let me take it one at a time. Firstly, I think you misspoke when you opened your presentation because you said that the British and the Italians are more easily assimilated than Hispanics. You used the reference to the Italians. The Italians couldn't get in to the same extent as the Brits did until 1965. They were the lower classes along with everybody else who lived in southern Europe. Now, when you ask me about the policy vis-a-vis the Jews and the American public, I don't blame the American public. I blame FDR, because he knew and did not take the leadership.
Not in 1933.
That was, I'm not talking about 1933.
Somebody
I am
did.
Talking about in 1937, 38, and 40. And he did nothing. And for me, he will always live in purgatory. But that's another debate. Now, the job of a leader is to stand up and educate, and then even if the mob can't be educated, to stand up to the mob and say, I will vote my conscience. Now, with respect to the Rwandans, let me say, no, we can't take a million Rwandans, but I will say to you that we can take more than 1% of the world's refugees. It is shameful that the United States, which has a good immigration policy, has a terrible refugee policy. For this great country to stand aside, and whether it's the Rwandans or any one of a 10 different nations that require that we reach out to them, to stand aside and to say we will only take 1% is an outrage.
Thank you, Mr. Koch. Mr. Buckley. You've made your opening remark already, so that the opposition may interrogate you. Who wants the first crack? Oh, come on. Don't all leap up at once. Mr. Glasser.
Yes, yes. It won't be about baseball. Rest easy. I said the question won't be about baseball. Rest easy. I want to try to discuss, I hope, with less heat and more light, the question of why you think that it is going to be more difficult for today's immigrants to assimilate into the American political culture than it was for the Irish, for the Spanish, for the Italians, for the Jews, for the Greeks, were said at the time to be impossible to assimilate.
For two reasons, both of which I adumbrated in my opening remarks. Number one, we permit bilingual education, whereas the great universalizing experience during the preceding 150 years was you had to speak the language that you spoke. Number two, we have a welfare system which reduces those economic pressures to conform to a system in which one has to make one's own way. This is no longer the case. Now, that pressure for so many years did two things. On the one hand, it put pressure on the immigrant to make his way economically, and also it galvanized the philanthropic instincts of people in his community who helped him or her during hard times. That is no longer here, and those are critical differences.
Both of those reasons seem to me unpersuasive for this reason. One is that there was a lot more bilingual education, as Professor Botstein has said, than you are admitting. And the difference is not bilingual education back then. And the differences are simply not as sharp as you say. Second of all, immigrant populations today are generationally learning English at least as fast a rate, and most of the studies show at a faster rate than previous generations. Number three, if your problem is bilingual education, work to get rid of it, even if I'm wrong about the other two facts. But why you would want to keep other people from coming in because of that, I don't understand.
That's the question before the House. If you want to talk about antecedent questions, I'll go back to...
Well, you're
to,
the one who's raising
them. Mr. Koch.
I'll go back to the Garden of Eden. The fact of the matter is that we, under the existing
there?
Situation...
There was a very bad immigration quota on the Garden of Eden.
Mr. Buckley, the impression that you give is that the immigrants who are coming here are debasing our society with their morality or lack thereof, their illegitimacy.
Who said that?
That's the thrust of what you're saying, that it is that they can't assimilate.
You're saying you get that impression, but
yeah.
I didn't give it.
Okay, but I want to. I understand that. Okay. I'm saying that when you find fault with multiculturalism, and I do too. When you find fault with the welfare state, and I do too, that wasn't brought here by the immigrants. That was imposed upon the immigrants. What I'm saying is that when the immigrants come here, they find that amongst whites, 22% illegitimacy, amongst blacks, 70%. But every one of them is married.
We have pointed out that at four periods in American history, there was a great moratorium, lasted some, in one case, 30 years. Now, that was the felt impression of the people and their Congress on the grounds that assimilation had to get a chance to work. Our point is that such a pause is not now in progress, but all of the indications that gave birth to the plausibility of those pauses are present.
And all that I'm saying is that the pause is a red herring, that what you have to do is to change the system, not the immigrants. They are desirous of learning English. They stand in line to learn English in New York City.
I'm all for it.
Mr. Sharry.
I want to get back to this question of the social distance between groups of immigrants today and immigrants before. When my Irish father married my Italian mother, it was a big deal in both families. The distance between the Irish and the Italians was perceived as great even 40 years ago, not to mention my grandparents, who had very little mixing between the races, primarily because of different languages. I don't understand. Given the intermarriage rates now, one out of three immigrants marries outside their group. One out of two of their children marries outside of their group.
Okay.
Don't you have confidence that this intermarriage and assimilation process is so strong that it can even supersede the power of the welfare state and multiculturalism?
No, not 100%, because the divorce rate has risen by 400%. during the same period. So maybe some of these things aren't working quite well. The Jewish community is frightened to death by the amount of intermarriage, which would, if you projected, would mean there'd be no Jews left 100 years from now. And Will Herberg, in his classical study, showed that there was a certain return to the instincts of one's grandparents in many situations. And so I don't think by any means it has been established that the kind of universal man has been procreated by this miscegenation.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Mr. Botstein.
I wonder whether you can answer my question without going into the past, but just strictly staying in the present. Would you agree that this is a very different America into which immigrants arrive than the America of opportunities, where hard work was rewarded either by success or at least by a decent living? The America they come into now is the America of rights, entitlements, the welfare state. Wouldn't you see a great difference that therefore requires different immigration policies?
No. I don't think. I mean, I think your colleague, Mr. Stein, threw me for a loop here with this Mayflower getting off the bench.
You promised to stay in the
present. No, but I'm saying the numbers of immigrants in American history, which from 1790 starts with about 500,000, so not two, has always entered an America where opportunity, where a sense of entitlement because
I'm sorry,
one wasn't
are you saying,
a born friend.
What was that figure?
In the number, right, of foreign-born Americans, approximately, by John Higham, one of the leading historians, 1790 is 500,000.
Coming into the country each year?
In the measured in the census of 1790.
As having entered that year?
Not entered that year, the census of 1790.
But what about the flow of immigrants
by 1800, it had risen to 600,000.
That's simply not true. That is not the average level of immigration.
I'm sorry with a historian.
Well, let me ask you.
Let's not argue numbers.
John Higham's against further immigration, by the way.
I'd really
I can't
like
be his sins of politics,
try,
I can't
I'd really
be
like
guilty
you
of.
To answer that question, because it's really at the heart of this debate.
Yeah.
Are you saying that the America is not different after the great society efforts of the last 30 years? The fact that they can come here and whether they succeed or not, whether they can make a living or not, they can stay on welfare. This is what drives the Americans nuts. And your side may not like that. You may. Mayor Koch, you call them a mob. Somebody else here said these are just poll numbers that we don't believe in. Look at the fact that 187 won by 4,700,000 Americans voting against illegal immigrants being on welfare and receiving free education and free health.
One of the tragedies is that one I don't think can make an argument by the fact that a popular vote, which is motivated by not the most admirable human instincts, is a basis for defining the good in our society. So I would say that the proposition one is a victory for the forces I don't happen to believe in this country. I do believe this country, for example, welfare eligibility. A lot of immigrants are not eligible for welfare. I think the description of America as different is really not substantial. It is still a country where people have to make their own way. Most immigrants do make their own way. The description of the immigrant as responsible for poverty
that?
Of the people who are born here is a wrong description of what actually is happening.
Dan Stein.
Mr. Botstein.
It's blaming people who are not to blame.
Well, are you aware of the fact that immigrants are now more likely than native-born Americans to be living below the poverty line?
They always have been. In the
are you aware that they are more likely to be on welfare than native?
Because
are
in,
you
the
aware
past,
more likely
in the
to
past,
be working
a lot of,
jobs?
A lot of welfare
but that's
was
not true. None of that was
done.
True in 1970. The 1970 census
difference.
Shows the exact opposite.
In 1870, there was the same complaint.
Look, if
the immigrants
had, if
are at the
had,
bottom of the economic ladder, they're more poverty,
let me ask
more
you
disease.
This question. If we had been taking immigrants at the level of the last 10 years for the last 200, do you know what our population size would be today? Tell me.
We have.
I can tell you, 2 billion people. You think that's in the national interest to continue what we're doing today?
We have been taking.
Go back out and take the fertility and take it for 200 years.
Mr. Stein, your facts are wrong. We have been taking for the last 100 years the same percentage level. We have the same percentage level of foreign-born people. The only pause historically. The only pause is beginning in 1970 after the 65 war.
Foreign-born population dropped dramatically throughout the middle of the century. Immigration was brought to almost a total halt in 1924. The Depression reversed it, and then through that post-World War II era, we had extraordinary economic growth with no immigration.
I'm
just
sorry,
like
the percentage of foreign-born Americans through the 30s and 40s was over 11 to 12%.
Now let me ask you this: if the rate we're going, our population density in our coastal counties is going to equal that of Haiti and El Salvador by the year 2020. Is that something you support?
Those are projections which are intended to scare the public. The fact is, immigration, if it is a sensible policy of immigration based on economic need and economic necessity and opportunity in this country and for other people, will not result. You are creating a scare tactic which has to do with some kind of open borders that has no control whatsoever, and no one is arguing.
And on an economic basis, how many immigrants do we need next year to fill all the needed jobs?
It seems to me that what the Jordan Commission has put forward seems reasonable, that there should be some regulation of immigration. We have now a million a year. They're suggesting about half that. It seems to me somewhere between a half a million and a million a year, the rates we've been accustomed to are perfectly reasonable rates to maintain. The question is what the policy should be.
Mr. Brimelow.
Are you going to change the flow here? I mean, if 50% reduction in illegal immigrant inflow is obviously a drastic reduction. That's our side, not yours.
I'm not in favor of the 50. I'm just suggesting in response to Mr. Stein's point that there's been a proposal to reduce it halfway. This 50%. Proposition we're debating today is shutting immigration all the way down.
It says drastically reduced.
I'm not a believer in drastic reduction.
50% is not drastic?
I'm not believing.
Are you aware that the U.S. Census Bureau has reported for the first time the existence of a completely new category of Americans, native-born Americans who can't speak English, about 2%?
There have been native-born Americans who cannot speak English throughout its history.
The Census Bureau, not according to the Census Bureau.
I'm sorry, there have been native-born Americans who have not spoken English throughout its history. There have been native-born Americans who can't read and write. There still are.
Are you aware?
That's a different problem. It's not the fault of immigrants.
Are you aware of the fact that...
Thank you, that's a rhetorical question. Thank you very much.
I'm sorry?
You'll get a chance to make us all aware, I'm sure, at some point in this debate. But now is the chance, thank you, Mr. Botstein. Now is the chance for Mrs. Huffington and Mr. Glasser to interrogate each other, starting with Mrs. Huffington questioning Ira Glasser.
Mr. Glasser, everybody on your side seems to agree that there should be reductions to the levels of immigration. I would like to really get that clear. Are you in favor of reductions? Because this is what we're debating.
No, everybody on our side is not in favor of reductions.
Are you in favor of
reductions? Some people don't have positions on whether or not there should be reductions. The American Civil Liberties Union, for example, which is interested in constitutional rights and discrimination on the basis of race and national origin, has no position on what the number should be. That's something for a matter of public policy.
But nobody else.
Because, as I said before, I don't think that's the issue.
I think it's pretextual.
And I think that it's impossible to discuss this issue without finding that out. You don't want to talk about the numbers. You want to talk about welfare. You want to talk about bilingual education. You want to talk about race and skin color and assimilation and population projections that everybody is guessing at. You don't want to talk about numbers.
No, we want to talk about numbers. The reason that we are talking about welfare and bilingual education and multiculturalism is because this is the reason why we want to reduce the numbers and to have a pause. And that's the main reason, at least in my case, it's nothing to do with color and it's nothing to do with ethnic origin. And that's why I want to stress this fact, that if you don't have an opinion on whether immigration should be reduced or not, you should not be taking part in this debate, because that's what the debate is about.
Well, then I would be happy not to take part in this debate if once you would talk about the numbers. You never talk about the numbers. You're talking about everything else.
What do you want to
know? You even before said to Mr. Botstein, don't talk about the past, and then you asked him to comment on the difference between now and then.
About now?
Yeah, as compared to then, you
said. I wanted to force him to talk about now.
You want to talk about the past, but you don't want anybody to answer. You want to talk about welfare, but you don't want anyone to answer.
No. I want to talk about the present, and I want to talk about what people are feeling without being condescending about them.
So because talk about the numbers.
Ira, the truth is that nobody around these tables, nobody is being affected by immigration. And we need to really pause for a minute and think of the people, the millions of Americans who are being affected by immigration.
Well, according to Julian Simon, they're being affected positively. He says,
absolutely.
All right, well, he says every immigrant who comes, on the average, makes natives richer. And every time we keep an immigrant out, on the average, we make natives poorer. So tell me what the problem is, particularly since the immigration numbers are at a lower percentage of our total population today than they were in 1910.
I agree that those of us here who are in the 1% in terms of income, affluence, jobs, and all that are being affected positively. We have more Korean delis, we have more Chinese restaurants, we have all those things that make our life more pleasant. We even have combined Chinese-Jewish restaurants.
Chinese restaurants are Jewish restaurants.
little later, Arianna. You'll be assimilated.
Yes, and now, Chinese restaurants are so Jewish that an hour after you eat, you're feeling guilty. So, for us, it's all great. But what about those people whose jobs are being taken away? And please don't tell me that there is no displacement. Please don't tell me that salaries and wages are not being kept down because of the millions of illegal, unskilled immigrants who are coming into this country.
How many illegal immigrants come into this country?
At the moment, right now, over a million skilled immigrants.
Illegal immigrants?
In the last 3 years alone, yes. No. In California alone, 300,000.
The INS says 300,000, half of whom come in on legal visas and disappear. Only 150,000.
No, come on.
Well, that's not true. The historians aren't right. INS isn't right. Only Peter Brimelow is right.
Not at all.
Hold on.
It's because I've read the census data.
Permanently staying here. We're not talking about those who come and then leave. We are talking about 300,000 illegal immigrants who are staying here, who go on welfare, who depress the public services available to them, and who therefore make fewer services available to those who have been
here. Now, you've talked about welfare again, but the fact of the matter is that if you eliminate political refugees who usually come here penniless because they're running away from persecution, the rates at which people use welfare, legal immigrants use welfare, is about the same as the rest of the native population, and every study has showed it. A little more, a little less, about the same. You know why? Because, among other things, most of them are ineligible for AFDC and food stamps for 3 to 5 years after they get here anyway. And the major forms of welfare, of course, are Medicare and Social Security, and very few of them are old. It just isn't true, Arianna.
This is just not true. I just have to correct that, because right now, people providing public services in California are not even allowed to find out if somebody is an immigrant or not, or if somebody is an illegal immigrant or not. And
what this
public service?
You're not talking about AFDC?
I'm talking about every service.
You're not talking about AFDC?
Health, I am.
You're
AFDC,
not talking about
absolutely.
Food stamps? No,
food,
you're not.
Everything.
All right, Ira, you can keep asking questions.
No, Ira, you know, I have to correct you on this. And it's absurd.
You keep making
that
these assertions.
Ira, an employer who hires somebody has the obligation to establish if that person is illegal or legal, but a welfare service, a health service provider, is not allowed to ask
whoever. Those are two different things, and you know that. You keep on asserting things that aren't true, but the fact is that AFDC payments are not the same as going into an emergency room
or
going to a public
school.
Well, you're talking about all services, and the laws and the practices are different.
Except emergency rooms, and I want you to tell me what you think that I have said is not true.
Because, first of all, you said health services.
Health services, absolutely.
But now when I press you, you exclude emergency services.
Everybody excludes emergency services.
Well, then what health services
Proposition 187.
What health services are you talking about?
I'm talking about a pregnant...
Do you think an illegal immigrant can walk into your doctor and get served?
I'm talking about the fact that an illegal pregnant woman can walk into any California doctor and get all the services paid for free. Yes, I'm talking about that.
Who pays?
The state pays. The taxpayers
pay. Based on what program?
Come on, Ira, please. You know, this is absolutely the fact. This is what 187 was about. Are you in favor of this or not? Are you in favor of illegal...
Yeah, I am in favor of a poor pregnant woman being able to get prenatal care anywhere she goes. I have to tell you something. And your notion... It is a mark of civilization not to turn people like that away. And your notion that that is a significant economic drain on this country is bizarre.
Are you in favor?
No.
Can I ask questions?
I'm losing control of the borders of this debate. Ira, you're supposed to be asking Arianna questions.
You wanted to talk about the numbers. The numbers are that as a percentage of the total population, the number of people coming in now, including illegals, is much smaller, about a third of what it was in 1910. Why is that a problem?
The problem is not the numbers. The problem is the need. No, the problem.
All immigration should be drastically reduced.
No. 1 second. The problem is not the numbers.
Just lost the debate.
Ira, the problem is not the numbers that are here now. The problem is that if we don't reduce the numbers that keep coming in, we will not be able to assimilate those that are already here.
And what evidence is there for that?
The evidence is that they are not being assimilated. The evidence is that we are spending $5 billion on bilingual education, and we are producing children
how much
that cannot
would we
speak
be,
English.
How much would we be spending on bilingual education if we stopped immigration now? $4.9 billion? How do you tell whether someone's assimilated?
what we are talking
about.
Are
you assimilated? Is Mr. Brimelow assimilated?
I'm not assimilated until you take me to a baseball game, which
I'm
you promised to do
I'm
on
going
August
24th. It's my lot in life to educate conservatives in sports and other things, including the Constitution.
You know, it's easy to make fun of each other, but the truth is that right now, if you have Americans, whether legal immigrants or citizens or illegal immigrants, who cannot speak English, they cannot be assimilated. Common
they
language is at the heart of it.
They are not speaking English at any different rates than they ever not spoke English. It just isn't true. Professor Botstein said it. I've said it. You keep nodding your head. The problem is that you're doing a lot of studies over there, those of you who are here for a couple of years, but you haven't lived in families very long. And the fact of the matter is that there isn't an immigrant family in New York where there weren't people who didn't speak English and couldn't read English. And to this day, there are many who don't speak English. That has always been true. And the fact of the matter is that people left. My grandfather, when he was 11 years old, was thrown out of his public school because he could only speak Polish. Now, they didn't have bilingual education, so he was out on the street, and he had to get a job when he was 12 years old. Now, I don't consider it a retrogression that today that kind of person might be able to be taught in his native language until he was able to speak English so he could stay in school. Well, that's all we're talking about.
I'm sorry.
The problem is, isn't it, that you're here and you want to keep it that way.
Oh, come on, Ira. You know that's not the problem, and I've made it very clear. But
what
I understand...
else do you mean when you say you want to drastically reduce the numbers, even though the numbers aren't a problem?
What's your question?
My problem is, if the numbers are not a problem now, which is what you said, why do you want to reduce them so drastically?
All right, you've asked that question, and she's attempted to answer it already. Thank you very much, both of you. Mr. Koch and Mr. Buckley. And Mr. Buckley can question Mr. Koch to begin with.
Mayor Koch, the floor manager in 1965, advocating passage of the immigration bill, which we're talking about, gave the following assurances. First, our cities will not be flooded with 1 million immigrants annually. And so they were. Secondly, the ethnic mix of this country will not be upset. Answer, in fact, it was. And finally, contrary to the charges in some quarters, the bill will not inundate America with immigrants from any one country or area. In fact, it has, for instance, Miami. Now, that was Senator Kennedy. Our point is not that the processes of democracy weren't observed in 1965, as was tossed into the discussion a moment ago, but that the implications of that act weren't sufficiently measured. Is that a fair thing to say?
Well, I think it's fair to point out that Senator Kennedy misled, if that's the quote, and I'm sure that it is, but everybody knew what they were doing. Everybody knew what they were doing, in my judgment, and Harry Truman said everybody knew what they were doing when they passed this legislation.
That was the same year they passed the Civil Rights Act, not thinking it would lead to affirmative action, which you've denounced.
Exactly.
Because they didn't foresee it.
I will say this to you, Mr. Buckley. I don't agree with my chairman, Ira Glassy, here on everything, and particularly the last round. I happen to support 187. If I had been in California, I would have voted for it. That dealt with illegal immigration, not with lawful immigration. And the problem is that in any discussion, intentional or unintentional, it's always fused together. Now, if we say that there are illegal immigrants receiving welfare, is that their fault, really, or is it the fault of the state and the federal government that it doesn't create the mechanism to weed them out? I mean, regrettably, in this country, the rich and the poor steal. They do. And the poor are as smart as the rich. And so if they can find a way to get on some subsidy, they will. But it's our job as legislators to change that. So what I'm saying to you, Mr. Buckley, is this. If you accept my statement that I want the illegals out, I support a trench, which I'm sure my colleagues don't, to keep illegal immigrants out. I want them, if after they're sent back the first time and they come back a second time illegally, I want them incarcerated so they'll understand that there's a punishment. I don't want Americans to be paying for the medical bills of illegal aliens except in emergent situations.
situations. I don't think that is heartless. There are limits as to what any society can do. But that has nothing to do with the legal immigrants who come here. I think they have created a better society. When you come to New York City, the Koreans, the Hispanics, they saved the city of New York in many areas that were just going down the drain and becoming slums, and they came in and rebuilt them. Isn't that to be praised?
You've got a logical problem, because to prove that somebody has made a contribution to a particular society is not sufficient reason to generate a conclusive or persuasive philosophical case for letting that happen again. I mean, I can understand a law in which Einstein might have been inadvertently excluded, but that doesn't mean that the laws were designed to exclude Einstein.
But if I may say this, when one-third to one-half of the Westinghouse scholars are immigrants from immigrant families, and a huge percentage are Asians, does it make any sense in this technological age where we're looking for brains, where we're looking for people to come in to our society and upgrade it, particularly in the areas of math, that we should want to exclude these people?
That's your first offensive question. I mean, I am being offensive, going on offensive, Mr. Buckley.
To which I replied that there are two comments that are appropriate to that question. Number one, why aren't Americans doing better? If you say, well, it's because it's a genetic problem, then I say, okay, then in that case, we can't do better. But I don't see what has changed in our genes that caused the SAT scores to go down 80 points in the last 10 years, but they have. Number two, if your argument is we ought to be extremely receptive to anybody who can outdo an average American in intelligence tests, then presumably that would be our new immigration policy, right? We'd send over a team to Peking or wherever, and invite them all over. In point of fact, we don't take that position because America is about something other than pure raw intelligence, isn't it?
And you are right. But it happens that when you allow these immigrants to come in, you're getting both. You're getting everything that's positive, where you see it to be positive, that doesn't relate to math skills or other abilities that help the society. And I am not for going over and selecting the cream of China. I am happy to rely on those immigrants that come here. You know why? Because the people who are willing to get up and go, historically, have been the best of any country. They're the ones with the courage. But I want to ask you this, Mr. Buckley. If in 1924 you were doing then what you're doing now, educating the public and denouncing unfairness and injustice.
This is a question, right?
What?
This
yeah,
is a question.
Yeah, no, yes, it's sir. A question.
Right. Yes. If you were doing then, in 1924, what you're doing now, and that immigration bill, which excluded to a great extent the Southern Europeans, the Greeks and the Jews and the Italians, would you have stood up and denounced it?
But I would have used whatever resources I had available. For instance, in 1965, I would have deplored the fact that the immigration bill set aside all considerations of intellectual quality. What became important then was family relations. So that in 1965, we were establishing a law which worked exactly in the opposite direction of those that you welcome. But incidentally, it's a very bad idea, and I don't need to tell you this with your experience, to generalize about legislative and comprehensive matters by individuals. He pulls out the pregnant woman, you know? I mean, that's kindergarten stuff. Obviously, nobody's going to stop looking after a pregnant woman. Nor somebody bitten by a rattlesnake. I'm sure if a rattlesnake victim goes to a doctor, he's not going to say, show me your papers and prove that you're illegal. The fact is that we're attempting to make a general policy, and that general policy recognizes that the medical resources of California, for instance, are strained. That's why you would have voted for 187.
Those are the illegals, yeah. Not the legals. Why do we mix the two together?
Well, because we're talking about a question of volume. When somebody comes in and has passed through the INS procedures and it's, quote, legal, as a human being, I don't think differently about him from the one who's illegal. In fact, the one who's illegal, I might feel greater compassion for.
But the fact of the matter is that it's the volume which is inordinate in a historical
You're
view
now
of the
telling this audience that you have greater concern and feeling about the illegal immigrant who had no right to come here, who ought to be back
if she's pregnant,
than the
I
legal immigrant. No, don't bring in this red-haired pregnant woman.
She asked me the question.
Listen, there's no question that emergent services medically are provided, and as Adriana said, under 187 in California. And that is the problem with people who want to close down or vastly limit immigration. They want to confuse the issue by merging and fusing illegal and legal immigration.
Thank you both. Thank you both, gentlemen. Peter Brimelow. Here's your chance, all of you, to prove that you've read Peter Brimelow's book, Leon Botstein.
Mr. Brimelow, you started this debate by saying something about race being destiny in American politics. You made a distinction between European politics. And for European immigrants, where citizenship and being part of the French nation, the German nation, is really a function of birth and place and language, I wonder why you think that American politics, race, is destiny. Is it merely because you think they're all going to vote Democratic?
You mean, you're asking me a technical question here. Why is it in the
policy
past?
A policy question which derives from, I think, your position on the immigration question.
Well, the point I'm making is very simple. In the past, it's simply a matter of record that ethnicity is what drives American political allegiance. If you don't understand that, it's time to read some more political science.
Mr. Koch.
Mr. Brimelow, why don't we give greater emphasis, instead of in your direction of stopping it, the immigration, to firm up the sponsorship affidavit so that everyone who sponsors a legal immigrant is then responsible for, in my judgment, up to 5 years until that immigrant has the right to become a citizen. Why don't we give that the emphasis instead of what you're emphasizing, which everyone believes is race?
Everybody believes it except the ones who've actually read the book. The answer is quite simple. There are all kinds of ways of reforming immigration that are rational, and they should be debated. For example, it's quite clear to me that you don't understand that the M65 Act has skewed skill levels downwards, actually makes it harder for these skilled immigrants to come in. Now, this is a bad idea. We should reform that policy. There should be national debates, and policy should be reformed on a rational basis. But to do that, we're going to have to have a cutoff for 5 years until we get
the reform. Skilled immigrants are about 20% of the total number, and the other 80% are reunification of families. That happens to be a basic democratic tenet that even the communists permitted when they said if someone is going to be reunited with their family, even though we don't allow anybody out of the country, we will allow those people out.
Nonsense. The Canadians have a family unification policy, but it's nowhere near as radical as the Americans. Family unification policy could easily be reformed rationally, and that's in fact what the Commission is proposing, and that's what I recommend in alienation.
Mr. Sharry.
Yeah, two questions about policy. One, as a conservative, I would think you would be in support of family values, and it seems ironic that you would then be against a policy which reunites families that are separated by borders. I find that ironic. My second question has to do with skill levels. In 1990, a bipartisan consensus in Congress passed a bill which tripled the number of skilled immigrants who could come into the United States. You refer to 1965. That's ancient history. The current law of the land is to give more priority over the last 5 years to skilled immigrants, and many American employers have come to depend on skilled immigrants who help them stay competitive in a global marketplace. What is wrong with those policies?
Of course, there's no reason at all why these families couldn't be reunited in their own countries. In many cases, these families are made up of people who marry, immigrants who marry spouses and import them from the old country. That's not reunification as Americans normally understand it. Now, it is perfectly true that in 1990, because of the disastrous workings of the 65 Act, they increased the skill level quota to 150,000. But at the same time, they increased the overall inflow. So at the behest, I may say, of immigrant advocacy groups like your own.
Very briefly, Mr. Botstein, skills are still low.
Aren't you really concerned about the consequences of the 65 Act having to do with the racial distribution who comes to the United States and not the numbers?
No, I think numbers are of the essence. If the numbers could be brought down, then all these other problems would go, even skill levels would go away. And I actually say that in the book, which is why I'm astonished to find Ira Glasser arguing that I'm in favor of ethnic
quotas.
All right,
thank you, Mr. Brimelow. Mr. Sharry. Mr. Stein must have a question for Mr. Sharry.
Frank, who are the major interests or forces that are pushing for high immigration, and what bad things would happen if we had, say, a 20-year period of, say, a moratorium?
The major interests that support immigration?
High immigration.
Well, your definition of high immigration and mine are very different. Who supports immigration? American employers who need skilled personnel that they can't find in local labor markets. American families who want to be reunited with close family members. People who care about the United States' leadership on human rights so that they can rescue refugees for whom resettlement. The specific
yeah,
interests.
The interest groups.
It's a very bipartisan,
growers,
as you know. From Mario Cuomo to Newt Gingrich.
Aren't agricultural growers a big constituency in there?
Agricultural growers? Yeah. They actually prefer illegal workers because they're easier to exploit. They can't move the fields, so they have to bring the cheap workers, right.
And you got the Ford Foundation in there, right?
The Ford Foundation.
And you have and you have church groups.
And church groups.
Right.
Right, religious, yeah, the Catholic Church. I wonder if Mr. Buckley knows this. The Catholic Church, an immigrant church, traditionally and currently, does very much support immigration. They believe that immigration makes America strong, and I agree with them.
Okay, and what bad things would happen if we had, 20 years of moratorium?
Well, what would happen? First of all, and specifically, families who are now separated by borders couldn't be reunited. Refugees who have nowhere to go and for whom the United States is now a safe haven would not be able to come here. Employers who can't find the kind of workers who are in competition with Australia and Canada and other countries for the kind of skilled personnel that they need to stay on the leading edge of technological leadership, they will suffer. And more fundamentally, from my point of view, rather than sort of the specifics, is we as a nation suffer. Our soul and our spirit is open and confident and embracing of new ideas and new people who make us better. That's the America I want to live in, and immigration is a vital part of that.
Mrs. Huffington.
Mr. Sharry, I agree with that, but would you also agree with Mayor Koch, who made a very important distinction, at least as a basis, between legal and illegal immigration? Would you agree that the American taxpayers, the hardworking American taxpayers, also deserve some respect and deserve groups like yours to allow for the fact that it's their money that's going to support for those services provided for illegal immigrants? Would you be in favor of, at the minimum, that?
As I stated earlier, I do believe there's a very fundamental distinction between legal and illegal immigration. I believe we should do a better job of controlling illegal immigration and reducing it, and it shouldn't be confused with legal immigration. Where I would part from my new friend, Mr. Mayor, is that I don't think that reaching into the schools and asking them to turn out kids onto street corners who don't have proper papers is the way to go. I do not think asking doctors and nurses to ask for immigration papers when people come in for immunizations is smart for us. I don't think that's the approach. I do think that the federal government, which reaps a windfall from immigrant tax dollars, estimates as high as $30 billion a year, do owe states like California and New York some impact assistance to deal with the real education and health problems.
Mr. Brimelow.
So you want to tax areas where there's no immigrants to support areas where illegal immigrants are settling?
I'm sorry?
You want to tax areas where there is no immigration to support areas of the country where illegal immigrants are settling?
No, I think that...
That's what you just said.
What I said was that immigrants pay an estimated $30 billion a year more in taxes than they use in services.
No, you're not...
Let me
ask my question, though, which is, what number of legal immigrants do you want?
I believe current levels are not the issue.
I want to know, the question is, what number of legal immigrants do you want?
I just answered your question.
Do you have a number?
Yeah, current levels, which are, as you know, 675 legal immigrants.
And 120,000 asylees a year and nearly 900,000 a year. That's what you want to see.
Okay. Peter, excuse me, the facts are this. I know you wrote a book, but here are the facts. 675,000 legal immigrants. 675,000.
You should try reading it, it's all there.
A small number of refugees, 100,000 a year. I think that is very doable for the United States.
Nearly 900,000 a year. Okay, so you go to the American people and ask them whether they want that.
All right, thank you, Mr. Sharry. Mr. Botstein and Mr. Stein. Assemble the podium, and Mr. Stein questions Mr. Botstein for 5 minutes.
Our population is now about 265 million people. Thanks to immigration, we're now seeing our population levels go up to about 400 million by 2050. That's nearly 150 million more people. Most of those people are going to be going in those coastal regions where half of all Americans already live. What do you think is going to be required to accommodate almost 150 million more people in those areas, and do you think we have the infrastructure and services to support them?
Yes, I do. I think population, unfortunately, is inevitable, except if there is a voluntary incentive to reduce the population, and that that we will have to find a way to, with a greater sense of the environment, manage growth in a way that is compatible. The density of our population here is not as great as that of Europe, which has managed very well. We need to be very concerned about how we do this, but it is not, it seems to me, a reasonable proposition, and the 19th century development, for example, France as a nation, to think that stable economic, stable demographics, and no population growth is a good thing.
What environmental goal or objective is made easier by having 150 million more people here?
The most important environmental goal would be that we might find a way to get along better with one another. If we could find a continue a nation that is not troubled by the kind of implied racism that the resistance to immigration presents.
Well, if you drive down a highway in most of these coastal regions like New York City or Los Angeles, you see already that the roads in particular are very congested. The growth patterns that were established in the 1950s and 60s around Mr. Eisenhower's highway system seem to be choking.
Well, we need a better public transportation system. You want to debate that? Yeah. I'm happy to debate it.
And how do you propose, and how would you finance 150 million more people living in these areas? Where does the housing, the road, the infrastructure, are the jobs, where is everything going to come
from? Because these 150 million people, whom you, let's assume they're all immigrants, are going to do what our grandparents did. They're going to create jobs, ingenuity, create new industries, all kinds of, a lot of them are immigrant-based, and they're going to create wealth. And with those people are going to create wealth. And with that wealth, it's going to be tax income. And with that tax income should be a better way of doing things, such as public transportation and other ways to avoid the ills. Don't blame the ills that we can't manage our cities on the immigrants.
So you sound like the economics of it make it sound like you think as a society we should all be trying to have a lot of kids, 4 or 5 kids each, and grow our population.
Now you're changing it. Now you're talking about my productivity, which I don't think is appropriate to talk on television about. But that's different from the question of immigration. We're talking about immigration, not how many children I have, right?
Yeah.
So you're suggesting to me that immigration is a bad thing because we're going to have too many people.
I'm suggesting to you that we don't need any immigration, so we shouldn't
have
it.
We don't. That's essentially, someone on your panel said, well, define America. Do we need it? I think, as my colleagues have said, ethically and morally and traditionally, we do need it because we are a nation about openness, about change, and about development.
Okay, okay.
We are not like the French and the Japanese.
Your entire panel has tried to build an immigration policy on the rhetoric that we need some kind of openness or what have you. Now, why couldn't we achieve that same rhetorical openness and moral responsibility with 3 immigrants a year?
Because traditionally, as I've tried to say, and all the historical sources have been bashed, we've had approximately as a percent of our total population, around 10% foreign-born. And I think the rates today, with the agreement of my panelists, legal immigration, not illegal immigration, at the rates we now have, is a sustainable rate that is traditionally compatible with American history and all the good things we now enjoy.
Let me ask you this question. What are Americans doing now in those regions where there's highest immigration? Do you know where they're moving?
Answer that and then go on the offensive.
The question is where the people with highest immigration
are moving. Based on the 1990 census, where are Americans going who lived in California, Florida, New York, Illinois, and Texas?
You answer the question.
They're leaving. And one of the reasons they're leaving is because the quality of life in those areas. One of the problems we have with immigration today is that the federal government lets in maybe 1 million immigrants a year, then you have people coming illegally as well. But as Mayor Koch well knows, the fiscal impacts immediately fall on the schools and the hospitals and the roads and the housing. The federal government loves to not care about the consequences of the immigration because it's the state and local taxpayer who picks up the tab. What the mayor's response was to say, let's say we're not going to ask what the immigration status is of New York City residents, and then the state turned around and sued
the federal government for the cost. So those who want to profit by immigration love asking the rest of us to pick up the tab.
May I answer the question? This is the old New York City story. There is no doubt that I believe that there should be a different way to take responsibility for the ports of entry. New York once was a major port of entry. And the question is, when they said New York dropped dead, you remember the rest of the country said New York dropped dead, they forget that, in fact, immigration is about the history of migration. People come to one place, they displace other people. The environment of New York City and Los Angeles will change as a new group comes in, another group moves out. Therefore, the nation has a responsibility for immigration, which cannot only be solved by some old-fashioned distinction. Just because the city of New York is the place they go, or L.A. is the place they go, they are totally responsible for something that ultimately benefits the entire nation,
because people moved
westward.
Why should they have it? Since you're asking me questions, the bottom line is that we really don't. I mean, you have to ask yourself, what's the purpose of immigration? Are we underpopulated? I say no. Is there a labor shortage in this country? I think most Americans would agree the answer is no. Are we trying to build Napoleon's Grand Army and sweep down and take over Latin America? No. Are we too homogeneous as a nation to be a legitimate nation? You guys seem to think that we are not. Our panel thinks that we are just doing fine.
May I answer your rhetorical question?
No, because you're asking me the questions and you won't ask me a question, so I'll answer it myself.
Wait a minute. Mr. Stein, you're asking, you choose to ask a question when you're supposed to be answering them. He has the right to answer.
Can I make the rhetorical answer?
No, I want you to ask me a question. Yes.
But since you answered your own questions, which I think are very admirable.
Thank you.
I'm going to do the same. And that is that I do think that economically we need an influx. We're not competitive globally. And the fact is, we have always profited from immigration,
I'm
a free trader. I actually believe that we should get the very best, and we've profited by that. So I think there's an economic reason. There's also a cultural reason. There's a cultural reason not to become like those European nations, which have become very racist and very insular. I don't admire the way those nations have developed. So in fact, yes, we disagree about what is good for America.
Now ask a question.
Now, what I want to ask for you is, why are you so frightened of immigration?
Not frightened at all.
Tell me why you're so frightened of immigration.
A country.
What bothers you?
A country is made up. Those academic institutions that profit from foreign students who get $1 billion in government assistance, they never have to worry about these considerations. A country is made up of its land and its institutions and its people. You take immigrants if you need it as a national priority. You do not take immigrants if you need it if it doesn't mesh with your other domestic objectives. You know, it was Pierre Samuel Dupont de Nemours who convinced Napoleon to sell Jefferson, Louisiana Purchase. Now, if an immigrant can come today and double the size of the landmass of the United States with unsettled wilderness, you might want to bring in 1 million immigrants a year to fill up the continent. But the age when you could use immigration to solve problems and fill up continents and uncharted wilderness, that is over. It ended 100 years ago. We've got to stop trying to do the impossible.
May I suggest two things? First of all, you're wrong. There are immigrants. Someone mentioned Einstein, Fermi. Without immigrants, the whole major scientific establishment of modern American history would not exist in
you
its current form.
You have no faith
so
in
the fact is, wait, not a matter of faith. It's about
true.
Fact.
And that
the
is second, simply not true.
And the second,
okay, so what
but the matter of fact.
Is, you want a policy that will dramatically reduce the numbers and give us a refined level of highly skilled
scientists. I didn't say that. You're saying
that's what your policy position
reflects. And the second thing is that when you say we don't need it, I think part of America's mandate is, in fact, opening the borders to people who
I
suffer
don't
religious
see that
and political
that
persecution.
That is not found anywhere in the Constitution of the United States, nor is it even a part of our
nation. That is our nation.
Gentlemen, thank you very much, both of you. It's time for closing arguments. And Ira Glasser this time is closing for the opposing team.
I am greatly concerned because of the descent of this debate nationally and here today into racial and ethnic terms. It is quite possible to debate whether we need immigrants economically or not, how many we should have, what mix of skills we should have. If that were all we were talking about, we would not have such a hot debate. That is not what we're all talking about. Julian Simon, a conservative economist who writes for the National Review and has never published anything for the ACLU, who published a definitive book called The Economic Consequences of Immigration, says that every time an immigrant comes, this country becomes richer, says that every time we reduce our immigration, the country becomes poorer. And he also says that the skill level is going up, not down, as Mr. Brimelow says. And he also says that the data in alienation are erroneous. Now, we are not going to be able to figure out who's right here, but I'll put my money on the conservative economist. Now, the fact is that when Mr. Botstein asked Mr. Brimelow, aren't you really concerned about the ethnic and racial makeup of the immigrants, not the size? He said, no, if you reduce the size enough, that'll be taken care of. Well, I suppose that's true. But on page 61 of his book, he says, the effect of the 1965 Act was not merely on the size of the flow, but that it, quote, dramatically skewed the sources. He goes on to say, they are coming not from Europe, the common homeland, of course, ignoring the fact that we all came from common homelands that were berated for being racist. The Italians were different, the Swedes were different, the Germans were different, the Irish were different. But we came from a common homeland, and now they're coming from, quote, completely different, arguably incompatible cultural traditions. He goes on to say, quote, an ethnic and racial transformation without precedent in history. He worries on virtually every other page about his son growing up in a world that is no longer predominantly white. Now, the fact is that he doesn't want to be called a racist, and I think that's a legitimate argument to make if you're concerned about that. But I urge liberals and conservatives alike to distance themselves from the darkest and the worst and the most ugly traditions that this country has had. The 1924 Act was a racist act. The 1965 Act was a civil rights act that got rid of national origin discrimination. The 1924 Act came at a time of unbridled racism in this country. It was racist against every immigration group. We do not need to restore that tradition in order to decide how many immigrants to have and what mix of skills we need.
Thank you, Mr. Glasser. Mr. Buckley. Closing for the affirmative team.
Mr. Chairman, a while ago, a figure was given that delighted the audience because it was said so contemptuously. It was a figure that America has only 6% of the population of the world but consumes 25% of the world's goods. You could just feel the tremors of self-mortification when that was said. But it seems to me that under the circumstances, we're entitled to investigate those figures and say, if we have 6% of the people in the world, why are we taking in 50% of the immigrants of the world? Any answers to that? We are. 50% of the immigrants. It's not like Germany takes none, Japan takes none. Australia charges you if you want to go there. So does Canada recently. It may be in part because since we have 25% of the consumption of the world, we become a place that people want to go. I was in Guantanamo 5 days ago, and I talked to Cuban refugees, and I asked one woman why had she left Cuba. She said, because I want to feed my child. That's an extremely good reason, among others, for leaving Cuba. But the answer is, with 25% of the consumption of the entire world, we become a magnet. Question, is 50% of the entire emigration population of the entire world not pulling our oar? Well, we contend it's not only pulling our oar, but it's going a little bit too far. It's going a little bit too far, as witness that there have been certain mannerisms and habits which are not a part of the American tradition, for instance, a failure to learn the language, are being ignored. And they are being ignored because under the auspices of multiculturalism, we tend to be increasingly indifferent to the problem. Now, I don't doubt that we could finance 450 million people if they came, because people generate more money than they consume in the course of a lifetime. I don't doubt that for a moment, but I do ask the question, why should we want as many as 50% of the people who want to travel to a country that consumes 25%, even though it has only 6% of the population? Isn't it fair to say that practically everybody wants to come to America? Hendrik Smith, writing a book about China, said, if the lampposts could speak, they'd say, we want to go to America. We should be very proud of that, but in the course of being proud of that, we should be very, very careful to be honest and sincere and diligent custodians of a tradition that oughtn't to be trampled upon by sentimentalizations of genuine problems. Don't you agree, Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Buckley, thank you very much. In answer to your question, Mr. Buckley, I cannot agree with your side or your side because I'm supposed to be scrupulously neutral. There is one argument made by the affirmative that did bother me a little bit, this idea that it's a good argument, what Americans want, what the polls say. Yes, what Americans want will ultimately triumph. The premise of these debates, indeed the premise of democracy itself, is that Americans are amenable to persuasion. That's what both sides have been after tonight, and I think they've both done a great job. Thanks to the panelists, thanks to our audience here at Bard, and thanks to the audience watching on PBS. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you to Warren Steibel, the producer, and thank you to everyone at Bard College who's had us here repeatedly, and the Leon Levy Institute. Thank you very much.
This program was a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for this firing line debate was made possible by a grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, the Annenberg Foundation, and the Laurel Foundation. For a video cassette of this two-hour debate, send $49.50 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.
This is PBS.
For a transcript of this two-hour debate, send $10 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.